All right. Hey, coaches, Mike Terso from Let's Talk Offense. Tonight, we got a Division I strength and conditioning coach from the great University of Oregon. We talk a lot about X's and O's and, you know, what we can do to better get offense. But lately, the topic has been, what can we do with this COVID lockdown that we can, what information and what workouts can we give our kids to do at home in order to get into some kind of shape to be ready for the season? Because I don't know where everybody's from right now, but you know, you might get that go time in June, July, late beginning of August, and then all of a sudden you're 3-4 weeks before that first game. What can we do? So with that, without any further ado, I want to introduce Coach Mark Davis from the University of Oregon. Mark, it's all yours, sir.
Coach, thank you. I appreciate the invitation to be here with you guys. Coach Feld and myself both have to apologize for the lag time in getting back to you. We've kind of, and he's especially been bombarded with requests from high school coaches, and so he had to sift through around 500 emails and parse this one out to me, and so I was happy to take it and happy to come speak to you guys tonight. Coach Terse asked me to come and talk to you guys about how to get in shape, and the thing I told him just now in a text message is there's no magic bullet that I can give you. There's no easy answers, but we'll go through a couple things here. I got a couple slides I can show you, and then we can open it up for questions, and I'll be happy to entertain any questions that you have. Let me share my screen here. Here it is. All right. Can we see that?
Not yet, Coach.
Not yet?
Yeah. You got to go back probably to your screen, and at the very bottom, there's like a green button down below. It says share screen. There you go.
How about that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. I've entitled my presentation, Now What? Like, what in the heck are we supposed to do with this now? This is a bridge that none of us have ever crossed, and I've been working at the college level for 25 years, and so there's no easy answers, but these were some things that we had to come up with, obviously, a couple months ago. Let me just really quickly give you my coaching path. I earned my Master of Science in Exercise Science at Arizona State back in 94. I was really fortunate because I started my strength coaching career at the University of Nebraska under Boyd Epley. And that was back in the glory years of Nebraska. We won two national championships in that time. So I really got to cut my teeth under some really good strength coaches. I was the head strength coach at Tennessee State in Nashville, which is an HBCU, for 3 years. We won two conference titles in football there in the time that I was there. I was then an assistant strength coach for the Olympic side. I worked with men's basketball and a bunch of Olympic sports at Vanderbilt. I got to go to five NCAA tournaments, two Sweet 16s, that kind of thing. Then in 2012, I got the chance to come out here, and I worked on the Olympic side. Also worked with women's hoops and women's volleyball for 4 years. And then in 2016, I actually had the chance to come over to football and work with Coach Radcliffe. And that was Coach Helfrich's last year. So I actually have worked under three different head coaches and three different strength coaches here at Nebraska with football, or at Oregon, excuse me, with football. So I've seen a lot of different ways of doing this stuff, a lot of different ways to slice up the pie, so to speak. How do we train our athletes under these circumstances? Well, it's a tough question. And I'll tell you the steps we used here at Oregon. We assessed, first of all, we got in touch with everyone across the country and assessed everyone's health. We then took access or took into account their access to equipment and facilities. Some kids had access to full home gyms. Other kids had access to absolutely nothing. So at a minimum, we spent around $5,000, I think. And we sent out a green and purple exercise band, a resistance band, to all 94 of our kids. And then we created an exercise video library. And I want to give you an idea of what some of these exercises look like in this video library. First of all, we got my friend, Coach Shaud Williams. He's going to do an overhead band squat.
Band overhead squat. And the purple band. All right. Feet about hip width apart. Band right above our head. Set our feet.
Okay. We got yours truly.
Okay, weighted sit-ups. We're going with a 20-pound dumbbell, but they're behind your neck. Now, it's important to remember that you're not pulling up with your arms and yanking on the back of your neck with that. We're working on the abs, right? We're tucking. When we come back down, we're staying tucked so that our shoulder blades don't touch the floor. Okay, that's the weight. Also, I have a 20-pound med ball. Same rules apply. As I sit up, I'm pressing, and I'm coming back down, my shoulder blades are staying off the ground.
Okay. Hey, bud. Noah. Hey, Noah. There we go. There we go. Here's some split jumps. One of our other coaches.
I was having a hard time. These are split jumps. Okay. What you're going to do is you're going to go ahead and assume that split squat position. When you have position, you're going to use your arms. You're going to alternate legs when you jump.
Okay. And we got some band pull aparts.
All right, we're going to do band pull-aparts with our purple band. We're going to grab one side of the band just like this right here, okay? Arms straight out in front. All right, and we're pulling. You want to make it harder, bring your hands in closer together. Arms still straight out in front. Pull.
Okay. Okay, and this is Coach Eaton. With some bench dips.
Next exercise, bench dips. Use a chair or use your couch. Sit down first. 90 degrees. Come back up. Bench dips.
Okay, and then we got burpees, which is actually named after a guy named Burpee, if you didn't know.
Next exercise, burpees. Make sure you emphasize getting full extension at the top.
Okay. And we got one last one here, and this is Coach Feld doing some Nordic hamstrings.
Nordic hamstring. You need to take probably two or three towels. Make sure it's nice and thick to protect your knees. All right, engage your heels underneath the car and control all the way down. Nordic hamstring.
Okay. And we put together probably around 60 different exercises with this type of approach, and most of the stuff was band resisted, that was simulating most of the regular lifts that we did in our workout. But how do you make it work? Well, there's different factors manipulating the workout that everybody knows. Intensity, which is the percentage of your one rep max, what the load is, how heavy it is, the volume, your number of reps and sets, your rest interval, and the frequency with which you're training. And obviously, under these circumstances, intensity is, you gotta assume that it's off the table, because we can't assume that guys have access to 200, 300, 400 pounds of free weights or a full set of dumbbells or stuff like that. So we're really left to manipulate their volume, their rest interval, and their frequency. So what may a typical day look like? Well, we got our guys training 3 days a week right now, and a typical workout might look like this. They might have four sets of 10 of those overhead band squats. They may have split jumps that you saw Coach Kagi demonstrate, four sets of 15. They might do four sets of 25 band pull-aparts. And these, obviously, these are really high volumes. You're going to get kind of smoked doing 25 band pull-aparts. But four sets of 35 regular bent knee sit-ups, four sets of 50 bench dips. Now, that's a lot of bench dips. Especially if you got your feet up, that's gonna smoke a kid. You might have single leg hip lifts, four sets of 20, and then one set of 50 burpees. And a burpee might look easy. You try doing 10 burpees and see how anaerobically challenging that is. And then try to do a set of 20, and then try doing a set of 50. That's going to be anaerobically really, really challenging for a kid. But that might end up being what a typical day looks like in one of our workouts right now. What are some other ideas that you can do? Well, you could do a what's called a 300 or a Spartan workout. And that's a workout that actually me and my son are doing in our garage right now. And you pick 8 to 10 movements. And even if you have weights, you're just going to use moderate resistance. So it's a good thing to use with body weight exercises. You use moderate resistance and you have high repetition. So for example, your first movement might be overhead band squats, 40 reps, maybe 50 reps. And you try to do that in the fewest sets possible. So you might get half that, 20 reps on the first set before hitting fatigue. Then if you're not trying to get all the way back to full recovery, so as soon as you start to get your wind back, you're going again. And if you're doing this correctly, you're not going to be able to get on a subsequent set the number of reps that you get on a prior set. If you do, then you took too long a rest in between. So it's going to be going to failure basically on every set. And you're looking for around 300 reps total with between 8 to 10 different movements, bench dips. If you can get 50 reps in, if you can get 60 reps in one set, good for you. That's the intent, is to try to one set all of the movements, but you should be setting the resistance at a moderate enough height that you can't one set everything. So band upright rows, for example, you might get 15 of those on the first set. Then you might get 12. I mean, it should be a law of diminishing returns. So you shouldn't ever be getting the same number of reps. You shouldn't be getting five sets of 10, for example. You shouldn't be pacing yourself on a Spartan workout. You should be going to failure on all your sets. And you have to complete all the reps that are given movement before you move on to the next and keep track of your time. And so the next week when you go back to doing that workout, you should be trying to beat the time that you did the week before. Another idea is a circuit workout. And this is a workout that we did. I learned it at Nebraska. And it was our main off-season workout. And again, you pick 8 to 10 movements. It's best to alternate upper and lower body movements, and then throw in abdominal movements in there as sort of an active rest, and then set a time window. So for example, the circuit that we did at Nebraska was on an 80 second time window. And basically every 80 seconds, you're doing a set of 10 of something. And if you have the buzzer sounds and the 80 second time window begins, and if it takes you 30 seconds to do the reps, the set of 10, you have 50 seconds to rest. If it takes you 20 seconds, you have 60 seconds to rest, and so on. But every 80 seconds, you're doing a set of 10 of something. And so we started out doing a set of 10 squats. And it should be something that's fairly rigorous to start this out. So it should be like a band overhead squat or a single leg pistol squat or something like that. And then moving on. And again, every 80 seconds, you're doing a set of 10. And after three sets, move on to the next movement. Factors to consider when you're putting these workouts together is, number one, the age of your athletes. This stuff that I'm showing you is stuff that we're giving to 18 to 22-year-old college kids. If you're working with like 14-year-old freshmen that don't have any strength training experience, these are not necessarily going to be the best things for your kids to do. And closely related to that is also their level of development. If you have a kid that hasn't done anything since this COVID quarantine start, you don't want to start them out on a 300 workout or a Spartan workout. That's going from 0 to 80 miles an hour in one day. And you're looking at some real problems with that, the least of which is going to be extreme muscle soreness. But, you know, rhabdo is something that we've heard a lot of in this field in the last several years. And that's a legitimate concern. If you're going to throw kids into something like that, make sure that they have the proper level of development and they've been doing something before they get into something that rigorous. Obviously the equipment that they have available, the implements that they have access to, is also going to be, something to consider. And you know, this is something that we did here at Oregon is we got kids all over the country. We all have kids that we keep in touch with. We've divided the team into about four groups, about 20. And so I've got kids in Hawaii. I've got kids in Virginia. I've got kids in Florida right now that I'm trying to keep track of. But one thing that we've done with our kids here locally is one of our kids is renting a house with a two-car garage. He's got some equipment in it, and we've taken some equipment to him, med balls, battle ropes, trap bar, some old dumbbells and stuff like that. And he's kind of created his own gym, his own local gym in this two-car garage. And so he's reached out to other guys that are local, and they're all coming over, and there's nothing prohibiting them from working out together in this garage. And for you guys that working at the high school level, your kids all ought to be in at least the same city. And I don't know there's anything stopping you from equipping a few guys' garages or home gyms with additional equipment that you have from the high school weight room and providing it to them so that they can use it there. Maybe you get 6, 8, maybe 10 home gyms, home garage gyms that other kids in the area can get to. And that can be one possible solution to this, since they're probably not allowed back into the high school weight room at this point. I know our kids aren't allowed back in our weight room right now. That's really all I had. I figured you guys would have more questions of a specific nature, and so I'd open it up to you. But this is my my work email. I encourage you to write it down. You can reach out to me. My phone is synced up to that, so even though I'm not in the office, I get all my emails to work, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you have specifically that way. But I can open it up right now to other questions that anybody may have.
Coach, I guess I'll go ahead and start. Okay. So with Oregon, with not just Oregon, but a lot of high school teams running up tempo, no huddle type offenses. Mm-hmm. And most of us at the high school level are not too platooning. So, you know, you got basically probably a majority of the players playing both ways. What type of, I guess we're going to call it off-season aerobic conditioning, would you recommend?
Well, right now we're having our guys run basically three times a week. We do a speed school, and this is something we'd be doing even if we were in session right now. We do speed school on Mondays, which is basically going back to basics and reteaching and relearning the basics to sprint mechanics, you know, knee up, toe up, doing wall drills, doing arm drills, seated on the ground, doing band resisted sprinting, doing free sprints. And Monday is always speed school, and we'll do that before any lifting. And it's in their home programs now. They have speed school every Monday. Then on Tuesdays, we'll do change of direction running. And Thursdays, we'll do more speed endurance. And those are all, you know, regular periodized workouts where we're gradually increasing the volume and decreasing the rest interval to where we're basically at a get to be about a 1-to-4 work to rest ratio. That's really what we do during the summer for our kids here as well. And we'll run the same stuff that most people run. We'll run gassers, we'll run half gassers, we'll run 300 yard shuttle, stuff like that. And we'll gradually step that up over the weeks. So guys improve their work capacity. One of the other things that we do now, and see, we don't really run a lot of tempo that much anymore. If you watched any of our games, we don't run like the tempo that Chip used to do. And to get good at that, you really got to, it comes down to your practice tempo. And we practice at a fairly good tempo, but it's slowed down from the years that when Coach Helfrich was here, we don't practice at a pace that's that quick. Just on a personal note, one of the things that I've seen over the last 4 years of working with three different coaches is the faster you run at practice, the more mistakes got swept under the rug and not addressed right then because you were hurrying to get to the next play. We're taking more time to address mistakes during practice right now, and we've gotten a lot better at that. One of the things we do, though, from a weight room standpoint, is that we do the lifts on tempo. We'll do our main meat and potatoes movements, our platform movements, on a 2 minute time window. And most platforms have two guys, three at the most, and we'll say, man number one, set number one, go. And they'll go. And then as soon as they're done, they're doing an auxiliary movement. Everything is supersetted. Then the next man is doing his first set, and then he's doing his auxiliary movement. But everything is supersetted, and it's on a cadence. So it's a first man, second set, you're up, go. And so there's not a lot of standing around, and guys are not working at their own tempo. They're being guided on that. And so we're getting a lot of work done because, again, everything is supersetted, and we'll do – about 3 or 4 platform movements, and then we'll break down into stations, and in each station has 2 or 3 movements to it. So we're doing 12 or 15 movements in a workout, everything's supersetted and the big stuff on a cadence. And so people always say, doesn't that take away from maximal strength? You have to have maximal recovery to hit maximal loads. And the answer is yeah, but we're not training power lifters. None of us are. We're training football athletes. And so we need them to be strong. Yes. But we need them to have high lactate threshold and high anaerobic endurance. And those are things that are done when you're pacing.
Thanks, Coach.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Yes, sir. It did. Thank you. Got a question that was typed into the message here by Coach Kreutz. He was asking, could you say that, what was Thursday's run again?
Thursday's was more speed endurance. And so we're doing like hollow sprints on that day, or it's called an in and out, where they're striding for 20 yards, then sprinting for 20 yards, then striding for another 20 yards. And so it's like a 1-to-2 top speed to striding speed ratio. And then they're doing a lot of skill specific drills that they're given to them by their position coaches on that day as well. And then they'll finish up with something like a 300 shuttle.
Excellent. Anybody else got some questions for Coach Davis? Please feel free to unmute and get your question answered.
Yeah, I got one. What are you having your guys do for flexibility?
Flexibility. Well, one of the main things that anybody can do for flexibility is get your kids to go through a full range of motion. One of the worst things that can happen, and we see it a lot with kids coming out, is that they've gotten away with doing less than a full range of motion. And you can increase flexibility and mobility of the joint just by having your kids doing a full range of motion. We don't spend a lot of time doing stretching. Now we'll have stuff after the lift or after the practice, We'll do some green band stretching. We'll do some foam rolling with them and stuff like that. We'll have, there's usually three stations, a green band stretch, a foam roller station, and then a guided stretch that one of our athletic trainers does. It's got a real kind of a yoga piece to it. And they'll rotate on those if they're not doing some type of recovery modality like the cold tubs or something like that. They'll do that. You know, having said that, one of the things that I've done in the past that I really like to do is the partner stretch after you're done with a practice or with a workout, because the body is more ready to be stretched after the workout. It's the best time to stretch after the workout as opposed to before practice. We do a dynamic warm up every day. That's a fairly extensive 10-minute dynamic warm up. That's karaoke's and high knees and A skips and all the types of stuff that you'd normally see in a warm up. And those types of things we can't stress highly enough as far as improving flexibility and mobility. But I like partner stretching after a workout or after practice myself personally.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Hey coach, I think this might be a little bit of add on what you're talking about there, but for kids that you see coming out of high school and coming into your program, yeah. Are there areas that you see, I guess, consistency where you're seeing deficiencies of lifts that they're not able to do very well? They're just not taught very well.
Coach, thank you for asking that question. Yes, we do. This is funny. I was having this conversation earlier this week with one of my former players at Tennessee State. He's 40 now. He's got a son of his own who's 13, and he called me about some isokinetic triple extension device or something that he was going to buy for like $5,000. And I said, he's how old? He's 13. And you're going to spend, I said, how many pull-ups can the kid do? And he said, not very many. And I said, why are you spending $5,000 on this damn thing when he can't do pull-ups? Teach a kid to do pull-ups. And that's one thing that I recommend to all high school kids. How many pull-ups can your kids do? I mean, I'm talking like hang all the way out, not the short arm thing where you're doing like this, but hanging all the way out at the armpit. That's one of the first things we test when they walk in the door. We don't test their bench, their squat, their clean. How many pull-ups can they do? Can they hold a 1-minute plank? Core strength is one of the worst things that we're seeing right now from kids. You know, I'm 54, all right? I just laid it out there. So for my generation, we spent every day on monkey bars and climbing trees and riding. But you know how much core strength that developed? Kids today are playing video games. They're on the couch. That doesn't involve any core strength. Get your kids actively involved in doing core strength stuff. We have them hold a 1-minute plank. They'll hold a 1-minute lumbar plank on a glute ham developer. We test them to see if they can do that. We put them in an overhead squat position with just the bar or just a stick and set them all the way down. Do they have the mobility to do that? Or are they all bound up? That's the first thing we do is we just stick a bar in their hand and go, can you sit down? And, you know, we say, oh, okay, we'll make notes. Okay, his hips are tight, his ankles are tight, his thoracic mobility is terrible. Can they do an overhead squat? Can they do a 1-minute plank? How many pull-ups can they do? Get your kids, and I'm talking about the big boys. Jake Hansen was our center. He was drafted in the sixth round by Green Bay. He could do 27 pull-ups, and I'm talking about, like, real pull-ups. Here's a 300-pound kid that can hang all the way out and get his chin over the bar for 27 to 30 reps. These are the types of things, you know, the body weight stuff might not be sexy, but it's tough and it's effective. And so I would say don't waste time with all these elaborate contraptions. How many pull-ups can you do? Can you hold a 1-minute plank? Can your big boys do that? I'm not talking about the stud running back now, the stud linebacker. They can all do that. Can the big boys do it?
No. Yeah. Appreciate that, coach.
Thank you for asking that. Appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Let's see here, coach. I got some things that are coming up in the chat here.
Okay.
Coach Staten, he says it's his first year being a strength and conditioning coach. He's wondering if you got any advice or guidance for building an efficient program.
First of all, I'd say stay in your comfort zone. And by that, I mean stick to what you know. Try not to branch out and do stuff that you don't know. One of the problems that I've seen, and I've seen this, I was at Nebraska when we were winning national championships, and people would always, high school coaches, hey, send us your program. We just won the Rose Bowl. Hey, send us your program. Well, why do you? I've got, between the five of us, we've got over 50 years of collegiate strength training experience, and we got Division I athletes. You don't have our athletes. Don't do our program. Stay to what you know. If you don't know how to teach a power snatch from the floor, don't put a YouTube video in front of them and go from there. You make sure you know what you're coaching before you go and do it. And again, I go back to what I kind of touched on before. Make sure your kids can crawl before they walk. I mean, build a base. Well, I mean, are they squatting all the way down to parallel? When our first 2 or 3 weeks in the off season, right after the season, we go back to our guys and we put a med ball on the floor. And they have to sit their butt down. And so that ends up being past parallel for some of the taller guys. And they got to touch their butt to the med ball for 30 reps, 40 reps, 50 reps, whatever it is. We're reteaching that range of motion. Make sure that before you're sticking any load on there, that your guys and your girls too can get all the way through a full range of motion. I would love to see more coaches just using a dowel rod or a stick and teaching an overhead squat and all the mobility benefits that you get out of a movement like that. If you develop mobile, flexible kids by putting them through full ranges of motion and stuff, doing thoracic mobility like Spider-Man's or movements like that, those are going to be some of the most beneficial things, I think. Teaching balance and proprioception, having your kids doing stuff on single legs. It doesn't make sense to load up the bar and have your kids doing a 300-pound squat when they have a huge muscle imbalance from left to right. Have them put one foot up on a bench behind them and do a rear foot elevated Bulgarian split squat. And hell, you might start out with just body weight on that to start out. And then you might just go to a bar. But that balance, that proprioception is what they need out there on the field. And that's what's going to prevent injuries, is strengthening of those assistor and stabilizer muscles. Yeah, you can get the main movers, but when you create imbalance, then your body has to react to that. And we have our guys working out on, they'll do 30-second sprinter holds on a gel pad or a styrofoam foam pad, just to create that imbalance. They'll work out on a Bosu ball, doing single leg squats on a Bosu, just because of the proprioceptive and stabilizing elements that brings into play. It doesn't necessarily, especially when you're talking about a younger team or freshmen or sophomores, kids going through their growth spurt, they don't need to be loaded up, but the balance and the proprioception and the core work, I think, are critical at that point. So, and again, it doesn't have to be sexy. It doesn't have to be like crazy stuff. Does that answer your question?
I hope so. I'm just kind of reading off some of these here, and then some of the questions were I think addressed earlier in your presentation. But I got one from a man, Coach McKenzie. He's asking if you guys still do like the no sweat practices, and if so, what does that look like, and what's the science and reasoning behind it?
Yeah. Yeah, Monday is during the season, we'll come in and we'll lift on Sunday, and we'll lift heavy on Sunday. Heavy being a relative term. And that ends up being kind of stepwise through the season. We start to take more and more load off the guy's lumbar spine. But we'll lift, and then they'll go through a jog-through practice on Sunday. Monday is an off day. Tuesday and Wednesday are our meat and potatoes days during the season. Those are our full pad practices. Those are our hitting days. And then Thursday is no sweat Thursday, and they're not in pads. They're in helmets. Everything is walk pace. We're not even jogging on Thursday. And the science behind that is the body gets broken down. There's football breaks down the human body. It either does it all at once or it does it, you know, over a period of time. It's like, you know, breaking a boulder. You can strike it 1,000 times, and then on 1,001, it shatters. And it wasn't that 1,001st strike that broke it. It was 1,000 previous strikes. And so same is sort of true for the human body. So we have to build recovery in there. We can't continually break these guys down. And so Thursday is sort of an active rest day. And then Friday, the day before game day for us, is Fast Friday, and everything is done at a fast pace. We're not hitting that day. I think we're in shells, or maybe it's just helmets. Everything is done at a very fast pace, and that is intended to prime the central nervous system. And the research shows that you can prime the central nervous system for up to 48 hours even prior to a competition. And one of the things we'll do then on game day is we'll do a primer where they're doing some explosive type stuff. They'll do like explosive high knees, and then they'll do explosive A skip, and then they'll do explosive karaoke, and then we'll get a med ball out, and we take our med balls on the road with this. So if we got a 5 o'clock kickoff, for example, we'll go at it's before pregame meal, probably go at noon and do our primer. And then they'll do like med ball stuff where they're doing an overhead slam, and then they'll do a punch, and then they'll launch it. They'll throw it as high vertically as they can, and then they'll do a couple of like broad jumps. And it's very limited in terms of the number of contacts they have. And we'll go right into to a special teams meeting after this. And this is on game day again. And so the primer doesn't involve a lot of contacts, but it involves just enough explosive movement to tell the central nervous system, turn it on. I hope that answers the question.
Excellent. Let's see here. If anybody's got a question, go ahead and ask it. I'm just kind of reading through some of the chat here. Okay. Here's one. What are the best drill? This is from Coach Chapman. What are the best drills and exercises for building speed?
There's no one right answer to that. I think before anything, you have to make sure that their mechanics are proper, and they're getting that knee up, toe up, arms in opposition. And making sure the arm mechanics are right too. And we spend time doing just the arm mechanics, just like a sprinter would do, where you sit them down on their butt and then you move them up to their knees, and then you have them standing and they're working through their arm swing, because guys' arm swing ends up, once it gets choppy, then their feet get choppy too. Your arms are what's telling your feet how high, how hard, how fast. And so it's important that arm swing goes from cheek to pocket, and we get in that upper arm parallel to the floor and to the ground in both the front swing and the back swing. So spending time on stuff like that is super important. We like doing a lot of resisted work, band resisted work, and then once you do resisted work, taking the band off and having them free sprint. We'll do partner resisted band stuff. We'll do stuff where they're running towing chains, and the chains end up being, I think, around 30 pounds. Anything where you can resist the run and then stand back and watch mechanics, I think is really good. And giving constant feedback as to what their mechanics look like. Is their head staying on center line? Are they wobbling all over the place? Are they running side to side? Are their arms crossing over while they're running? Are they getting too much torso rotation? Things of that nature. Anything that you can do from a drill perspective to reinforce that. I mean, that's why when you do warm-ups, doing the high knees, doing the butt kicks, doing the A skips, those are all what track athletes do to isolate and work on those particular elements of sprint mechanics. And so even when you're warming your kids up, give them feedback on what that looks like. Tell them not to take it lightly, because those are if they're just lollygagging through warmups, high knees looks like crap, and they're not getting their knees high, then their sprint mechanics are going to be off as well. If their A-skip doesn't have a lot of good snap to it, their sprint's not going to have a lot of snap to it. So don't let warm-up time be, you know, jerking around time. That should be it's time to get ready to play the game, and you're getting your body ready and your central nervous system ready to fire in the appropriate patterns, doing those types of things. So don't let them create lazy, bad habits when you're doing drills, even as simple as something as warming up.
That's great, Coach. That's great. Coach Serno has got a great question, and I'm going to kind of throw some info on this one as well, is that some coaches coach in, I don't want to use the word poor or inner city, things like that, but you got these kids that show up to the weight room, and they bust their ass in the weight room, and they're there, and they're lifting and all this kind of stuff, but when they go home, you're not quite sure what kind of nutrition they're getting. So what kind of recommendations do you have in terms of like nutrition for these high school kids?
Yeah, that's such a tough one, because so much of that is out of your control. You should see the problems that we have with 18, 19 year old full scholarship kids that are getting meals paid, and they don't even show up to eat. You know, we got an excellent training table, and they turn their noses up at it. So it's a real problem, even when you have resources. But for kids that don't have resources, man, that's really tough. And, you know, I had this similar sort of experience when I was at Tennessee State. Again, it was an HBCU, and we had a lot of kids that came from needy backgrounds, and it was all I could do. I tried to get as much nutritional supplements as I could, but we ended up, hell, if you can get a kid to eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and a glass of milk, and especially before bed, peanut butter is one of the best things that you can do, because it's so high in carbohydrates and in protein. That's one of the best things. And I had a defensive end that was outstanding at Tennessee State, and this is 1AA at the time, or FCS, and he was 220 pounds, I think, soaking wet, boundary end. But the kid was strong he's still the freakiest strong kid that I've ever seen. He was squatting 500-plus pounds for reps without even thinking about it. But we kept that kid pumped up with peanut butter and jelly sandwiches that whole season. And I remember a kid at a kid whose place I took at Nebraska, actually, who was on the 94 national championship team, who was unnaturally heavy. He started at guard, and he was always eating folded up PB&Js or something like that going into meetings. It's just how conscientious they are and how picky they are. If you got picky eaters, man, you got problems. And I don't even know how to address that, because we got picky eaters too. One of them named Kayvon Thibodeau, who was a five-star, and getting him to eat. I mean, you got to remind the kid to eat. I had an SEC he was SEC player of the year in men's basketball in at Vanderbilt. And we'd have 2 o'clock lift, and he'd come in and, "What'd you have to eat today, Shane?" "Oh, I haven't eaten yet today, coach." "It's 2 o'clock, man. 14 hours of the day are gone. You haven't eaten anything yet?" Kid's 6'6". Super picky eater. I wish I had a magic bullet to give you there. I wish I had a magic answer, but I don't. If the kid doesn't have any resources, I mean, you know, it depends on what you and your program can do for them at that point. Like I say, a PB&J and a granola bar and a chocolate milk go as far as a lot of other things at that point. I mean, chocolate milk, again, there's a great source of carbohydrates, calories, and protein. And something like that, especially right before they go to bed, if you got hard gainers, overnight when they're asleep, that's when the body puts bricks and mortar together and builds muscles. You don't you don't build muscle in the weight room. You don't get stronger in the weight room. You just go the other way. And so the time when the body puts itself together, make sure that the body has the bricks and mortar it needs when those anabolic hormones go up in the system overnight while they're sleeping. That's when they need that. So getting that in the system before bed is huge. But damn, tough question, not an easy answer.
Nice. Thank you, Coach.
Gentlemen, this is the time. Division One strength and conditioning coach, if you got questions, this is the time to ask. So if you got any, please unmute and ask it. I don't want anybody to leave here.
Coach, hi, this is Alejandro Smith from Mexico City. I want to know, what about the stage of plyometrics exercise? In what stage do you use this and in a competition stage?
How much are we using plyometrics during competition?
Yeah.
Not at all during competition. Plyometrics is something that needs to be applied really judiciously. And the general rule of thumb is kids should be able to squat 1.5 times body weight before they engage in plyometrics. And even then, you need to have the proper footwear and be doing it on the proper surface. Proper surface being probably the turf. You could do it on grass, but turf would probably look actually a little bit better. And proper footwear. But you gotta make sure they got the proper strength before they engage in a lot of plyometrics. But plyometrics are it's a high impact activity. And that takes a toll on the body. So plyometrics, even during the off season, you don't probably want to do more than twice a week. But during the in-season, the body has so many impacts. It's getting enough, really, what's by definition plyometric activity. So to train more of that in isolation is putting the body into an overtrained state. I wouldn't recommend plyometric training during the season itself. But during the off-season, probably twice a week, and probably limit your foot contacts to probably around 100, 120.
Okay. And with the age of the 9 to 12 years in off-season, it's recommended the plyometrics in the off-season?
In grades 9 to 12?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. The one thing that, you know, you guys have to take into consideration that we don't is kids that are going through puberty, they're going through their pubescent growth spurt. And if they haven't gone through that yet, it's important that you don't maximally load their skeletal system. Strength training at any age is good for the body. I mean, read the American Pediatrics Association's position statement on resistance training in children. They're all for it. I had my son starting out where he actually asked me if he could start when he was about 6 or 7 years old. And I had him doing, you know, 5-pound dumbbells when he was 7 years old. That does not hurt a child's body, provided that that's not a maximal weight. About the time you have him single rep maxing or doing overhead stuff or anything that's unsupervised, that's when it gets dangerous. Prior to puberty, again, you want to watch the amount of impact that the kid's body is getting. So that stuff, I mean, they can do general plyometric stuff. I mean, and just something like skipping is plyometric by definition. That's not going to hurt them. And doing power skips for height is plyometric by definition. That's not going to hurt them. It's just when they're doing like loaded depth jumps or something like that. That's something where prior to puberty, you really got to watch stuff like that. That's probably not advisable.
Thank you, Coach.
You're welcome.
All right, Coach Davis, I'm going to take one last question for you, then we'll call it an evening so you can enjoy dinner with the family here.
I'm good, Coach. I don't want anybody going away from this with questions still either. So
excellent.
I'm happy to stick around as long as anybody like to.
Excellent. Well, I got a question from Coach Ethan Pressler. He says, your thoughts on a game day workout. He says, I've seen some high schools and college programs doing this. Assuming that we have a 7 p.m. start time, what time would you do these on game day?
There's not a lot of magic to that. I mean, obviously, you know, pregame meal is something that, that, you know, conventional wisdom says is four hours prior to kickoff, so that the meal is digested and stuff. If you have a seven o'clock kickoff, you know, if you're going at two or three or right after when school lets out, doing a type of central nervous system primer, it's not really a lift. We do on our Fast Friday. I'll give you an example. Fast Friday for us, we start out, we do an on the field lift. What it consists of, we have a portable on the field platforms, which is basically plywood with that's wrapped in rubber, so we don't drop the weights because we had an incident a couple of years ago where we had kids, we took weights out onto the practice field and we had them dropping them, and we ended up with holes all over the field, and that was an unpleasant conversation the coach had to have with the head man there. But we got that repaired, and so we learned from that not to drop weights overhead onto turf, because it actually does leave holes in the field. But so, but they'll end up doing, like, they'll do a set of three hang cleans, then they'll step over the bar, they'll set the bar down, step over the bar. There's a med ball there. They'll do one vertical throw, then they'll do two broad jumps. Then they'll come back to the back of the line. In the back of the line, we'll have elastic bands that they'll do some upper body punches with, and then there's a med ball at the back where they'll do some punches where they'll just take the med ball and slam it into the ground, not an overhead slam, but like from the chest punching it into the ground like three times, and then we'll do like three rounds of that, and then we'll go into Fast Friday workout. And so that's separate from the game day primer. The game day primer itself, you know, you could actually do some stuff like a barbell hang snatch with like really lightweight, like just a bar, just 65 pounds on there, something like that. That's full body, that's ballistic, that's explosive, where time of movement is a consideration. Those would be good movements to do to prime the central nervous system. Nothing that's slow, nothing that's single joint. It all should be multi-joint, full body, explosive stuff. But anything like that you can do, and you know, you can just take from the examples that I gave you, those are elements that would be good to prime their central nervous system. It shouldn't take more than on game day 5 minutes. You know, you don't want to work them into a froth where they're like, damn, I need a rest because I've got a huge accumulation of lactic acid. You've gone too far at that point. Remember what you're trying to accomplish there. It's not strength building time for a game day workout.
Coach, I'll piggyback that. We tried that for the first time last year, and I thought it was highly effective. And you're right, it doesn't take very long at all.
Yeah.
I want to go back earlier when you were talking about, you know, the coach asked about starting a program and, you know, keep it simple, stay in your wheelhouse. I think kids think it's got to be really sexy. It's got to be a lot of heavyweights. I've done this for a long time. How do you convince kids that these bands and these other things are the right thing and get it through to them? They're
Well, the first thing I'd do is I'd put them on the pull-up bar and say, how many can you do?
I wrote that down as a note here. That's one of the first things we're going to do.
I mean, and you can tell them I said this. I mean, you get a scholarship to Oregon. When you show up, we're not checking your squat. We're not checking your bench. We don't give a damn. We don't care how much you can clean. How can you pull up? Can you do an inverted row or a reverse bench? I don't know if you know what that is. It's basically the opposite of a bench press, where you're hanging from the bar and your feet are either on the ground or they're elevated, and you're pulling up and you're touching your chest all the way to the bar. And that's another thing we'll do, is we'll do an inverted row, keeping up with a metronome, and we'll do sets to failure there. And we got kids that can't do one full rep pulling themselves up to the bar on an inverted row, and much less keeping up with the metronome. But those are the types of things. I mean, I think everybody has gotten wrapped up in, oh, what's my 40 time? What's my vert? We don't test any of that stuff. I don't even know when we first test 40 yard dash time, but like, we don't give a rip about that stuff. Can you play football or not? And then it's basically the ABCs of strength training. Yeah, I mean, can you do this? It doesn't matter how much you think you can clean with really crappy technique. It's how many pull-ups can you do?
Oh, that sounds great. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a tough question to get kids. I mean, hell, put me in front of them. I'll tell them.
I might be calling you.
I'm happy to do it, man. You can tell them I said it. You can tell them that I'm speaking for all of us on our staff now. That I don't know a whole lot of staffs where they check that stuff coming in the door. It doesn't matter.
I think that goes with times have changed. Because I remember back in my day, it was all about how much you could bench, how much you could squat, and things like that, you know.
Well, and, you know, when we got guys that are training for the draft, then, yeah, those things are important. Those benchmarks the scouts are looking at, they're trying to weed people out. When we're looking at a high school senior who's vying for a scholarship, can they make plays? Can you play football? My son just finished on a high school team where, you know, they had starters that couldn't bench 225. It didn't matter. They can make plays.
Excellent. Let's see here. I'm getting lost in these group chat messages here. What would you recommend for a middle school lifting program? And he did say, other than working on like good form and learning the lifts properly.
Yeah. You know, I would encourage those kids to do a lot of dumbbell work and a lot of isolateral dumbbell work. That is, get on a bench and work just dumbbell bench with the left arm, and then switch it over and just do the right arm. Single arm dumbbell snatch. I think that'd be a great time. I mean, I'm so jealous of guys that get to work with kids that age, because that's the age where you can really have an impact on them. I get them when they're 18, 19 years old, they're already hardwired, and teaching a kid to do these movements is super hard. Whereas if I got them when they were 12, 14, 15 years old, taught them how to single arm dumbbell snatch, they'd gain a lot of explosiveness, a lot of core strength, a lot of mobility, a lot of stability. But I'd have them working a lot of dumbbell stuff and a lot of body weight stuff. I mean, have them do hanging knee raises and then have them go to a hanging leg raise. Have them do inverted rows, side planks, front planks, all that kind of single legged everything. Walking lunges, I think, are outstanding, you know. You're not gonna hurt yourself doing walking lunges 9 times out of 10. It's super easy to do. You can do all kinds of variations. You can do explosive walking lunges. You can do lateral lunges, reverse lunges. All of those types of things teach balance and coordination and proprioception. Whereas doing a static squat in place, you get some of those elements, but certainly not all of them.
Thanks, Coach. One from Coach Lewis. He says, you mentioned working out 3 times a week. He says, what would you change if the team had a workout Monday through Friday? He says, do you approve of 5 workouts a week method in the off season?
You know, I cut my teeth on a program that was 4 days a week, and that was the system that we used at Nebraska. And that was a system that I carried on to Tennessee State and to Vanderbilt with my basketball guys. Is we trained 4 times a week. 5 times a week is a lot. You know, one of the main elements that I find in most aggressive programs is recovery time. And again, that's this, you know, sleeping, getting your calories, getting your protein, rehydrating. Is there adequate time for that? And, you know, the general rule of thumb is you wanna not train the same muscle group within 48 hours of hitting it again. Working 5 days a week really kind of bites into that recovery window. So I'm not saying it's impossible. It's possible. I would have to see what the structure of that workout looks like, what those days look like, how long they are, how involved they are, you know, how much load is going on to the musculoskeletal system, and particularly the central nervous system, because you can overtrain somebody in a heartbeat. That's really easy. The science of it is, the art of it is to train them to super compensate, not to come out under, but to come out over. So 5 days a week is possible. But I'd sure as heck like to see. I mean, we train 5 days a week. We just don't train in the weight room 5 days a week. We're running. We're in our off season. We do the fourth quarter program on Tuesday and Thursday, which is basically an A station conditioning workout, followed by a halftime, followed by a four station workout. And those two things are going, you know, like I said, every Tuesday and Thursday with speed school on Monday. And then on Friday after a lift, we usually do a finisher, which is some type of sled push or stadium run. So they're actually doing some sort of conditioning / running four times a week. So I can't imagine putting a lot more strain on the system than what we're doing right now. Like I say, anything's possible. I've seen six day a week workouts, not at the college level, but I've seen them. I don't know that they're advisable. You know, there's a law of diminishing returns with regard to strength training, which means that more isn't necessarily better. And you know, some workouts I see are, they end up being 2 hours, and I'm going, what in the hell are you doing for 2 hours? If you give me your, and this, the research backs this up. If you're giving me your best effort on three or four sets of bench, there's no point virtually to doing three or more sets than that. Why are your kids doing 8 sets of bench, 10 sets of bench? What kind of effort were they giving in the first four? Again, there's a law of diminishing returns, which shows that you're not getting all you're doing is tearing the body down further with those additional 3 to 4 or 5 sets. Give me your best effort for 3-4 sets, and then move on to something else.
Thank you, Coach. Gentlemen, I don't see any other questions in the group chat. Anybody got further questions?
I had one more for you, Coach.
Yes, sir.
Do you guys at what point or at all in your workouts, just kind of seasonally, at any point, do you guys switch to more speed-focused lifting versus strength? So, like, I've seen some coaches talk about they'll go to and more so on the track side of the house, right? They'll focus on kind of full range of motion, but like fast squat, so lightweight. But they'll focus more on going to speed or something to that extent. Do you guys do anything like that? Is that something that you recommend, that you see any benefit for kids being able to do that as far as kind of rotating, you know, from kind of strength and power to more of speed and mobility piece?
Yeah, we don't do things like that. I mean, we'll do triphasic training where they'll do, for example, they'll do a heavy set of squat, and then they'll immediately go and get into some bands and do triphasic jumping. Or they'll go over, we have bounding tiered steps in the weight room, and they'll do a heavy set of squat, and they'll go immediately over, and they'll do tiered bounding. And those are all kind of transitional, kind of bridging type movements to create what I call field strength. It's taking weight room strength and try to bridging the gap and making that, teaching the central nervous system to using that in an explosive way. We don't do the light squats like that. I have seen and heard that done with other sports. With football, what we're thinking, as well as, I mean, the main reason we're training kids in the weight room is to prevent injury. And in order to do that, we have to load them up. and make their joints and their connective tissues thick and solid and strong and have integrity to resist the pounding that goes on in football that doesn't go on in other sports. So injury prevention is our main thing, and performance enhancement is a kind of a happy side effect that we get from it. But we don't do the light stuff like that. It's more the transitional pieces. You know, we'll do the same thing with bench. They'll do a heavy set of bench and they'll immediately get down and get into a band around their chest and do 3 to 5 triphasic push-ups. And then we have a punch pad that's on a spring on the back of the rack. And they'll go and hit the punch pad 10 times as rapidly as they can. And again, those are sort of transitional upper body movements to create an explosive power. But we don't do the super light stuff like that.
Awesome. Appreciate that, Coach.
You're welcome.
Coach Ward was asking, what's the best book to read on strength training?
My Bible is Science and Practice of Strength Training by Vladimir Zatsiorsky. That book's been with me for a long time, and that's had as much impact on my philosophy of training as anything. Science and Practice of Strength Training by Vladimir Zatsiorsky. Zatsiorsky was the former head of physical training for all of the sports, Olympic sports in the Soviet Union, the former Soviet Union, for 25 or 30 years. And the insights that he and his colleagues came up with during that time is stuff that we can all still use, in my opinion.
Thanks, Coach. Coach Fernandez was asking, Coach Fernandez, I hope, correct me if I'm wrong, he's asking, what do you think about HIIT in football? I'm not quite sure I know that acronym.
Is your friend a high intensity training, HIIT system, or?
Maybe that's what it is. Yes, HIIT. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah, HIIT's, I don't know that I am in a good position to speak on HIITs. HIITs historically has been doing high volume training, one set of exercise to failure, and then moving on to something else. And that came about, I remember when I first got into the field in the late 80s and early 90s, it was a big sticking point, and coaches just got into battles because there was one camp that believed in Olympic training and merging powerlifting and Olympic lifting, and then there was the HIIT system, which basically was done on machines, and you basically hit one set to failure. And I don't know all the ins and outs of high intensity training. I mean, I think that there's something to that from a base building standpoint and from a hypertrophic standpoint, and I think that young kids could benefit definitely from something like that, because except for the to failure part, especially if they're prepubescent. But I mean, I think that it has some validity. I'm of the opinion that you need to be doing explosive type movements to train your central nervous system. Your body's going to do what you tell it to do. And if you tell it to move a lot of weight at a slow speed, that's what it's going to get good at. And if you tell it to do a movement like a hang snatch that takes place in between 7/10 of a second and 4/10 of a second, if you're really good, I would rather have my athletes doing something like that. But when they're just starting out, I think that there's a place for everything like that. And so long as they're not going to failure on stuff, HIIT system, it has some practical applications for young kids.
Thanks, Coach. And just real quick, can you repeat the author's name that you referred to as your Bible?
Zatsiorsky. Vladimir. My Bible's at the office.
That's all right. So, Coach Haberkamp typed it in. He must have already Googled it. That's awesome. All right.
Brother, it's already in my Amazon cart.
Oh, nice.
Hey, all right.
Very nice.
Good reading. Good reading.
There's the Amazon link for you guys.
Appreciate you, Coach.
Yes, sir.
Anybody else got some questions? I got nothing in the group chat. This is an opportunity to find out or get answers, I should say.
And again, guys, if something pops up in your mind, like after this, mcdavis@uoregon.edu, shoot me an email. I'm much more responsive to that than the phone, which I let ring a lot of times if I don't recognize the caller ID. But I don't let anybody hang with emails. Now there might be some lag time getting back to you, but I will get back to you.
Excellent, Coach. I appreciate here, let me get this thing going here. So you can see all my writings on the wall here again. I want to thank you, Coach Davis. I really, you know, this is I don't even know if you want to call this a shot in the dark, but it was like, you know what, I'm a Ducks fan. I'm going to contact, see if somebody would be willing to help us out. And a couple of days later, all of a sudden I get an email from you. I'm like, oh my God, this just happened. I can't believe it. So I'm a firm believer of, you know what, sometimes you just got to ask, and you can find people like yourself and like the other coaches that are on this call that are willing to help one another. And you're not having to pay hundreds of dollars at a clinic or, you know, things like that.
Absolutely not. No, I'm thrilled to have the opportunity. I'm just honored to be in your presence right now and having this time to share with you. And I hope that, you know, you took one nugget away from this. I hope one element of it, I know all of it wasn't, but I hope that you got something that you can take back to your kids and use effectively. And if not, shoot me an email and let me know what else I can do for you.
Yes, sir, Coach. And again, with that said, we're going to go ahead and end this thing. It's getting kind of late. People got to get some dinners and get kids to bed and things like that. Coach Davis, again, appreciate you. Go Ducks. And for the rest of the coaches, I really appreciate you showing up. I'm really glad we didn't have another Zoom snafu like we did last night. Until then, you know, keep your eyes on the website. We'll try to host up some more Zoom calls. And if you need that email from Coach Davis, I have it. So I'll post that along in our group. Again, I'm repeating myself, Coach Davis, you're the man, sir. I appreciate you.
I ain't the one.
You have a great, good luck this season. Good luck.
Thank you. All right. Good luck to you guys too. Let me know how things go. I mean, if you implement some of this stuff and it works, or if it doesn't work, shoot me and say, hey, I think you're full of it on this one, man. I think it didn't work for my guys, and we'll go back and revisit it.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you, Coach. You have a good
appreciate
night.
You guys.